Hi, welcome to the second part of my CB2 micro video series. If you didn't watch the first part, let me just tell you that the CB2 micro is a little do-it-yourself retro computer, and we built it in the first part, and today I'd like to show you the basics about using it. But before that, there's two more things I'd like to tell you before you build your own kit. The first thing that you should know when you build your kit is that you need to apply a lot of solder to the sides of the mini USB connector. Because I applied too little and the front of it soon came loose, and it's hard to fix afterwards because with your adjacent parts already mounted, there's not a lot of room here for your soldering iron. But I eventually managed to fix it by adding some solder here and a little here, and now it seems to be stable again. So use a lot of solder here, and when you're soldering these upper parts, always increase the temperature of your soldering station to 360°C, as Custis recommends. The second thing I'd like to recommend you is to get yourself such a pin row for very little money. This was, I think, a 20 or 40 pin row, and this is what's left of it now. And get yourself a few of these little jumpers in case that you don't have any left over from old PC parts. And when you build your kit, immediately solder two rows of three pins here and two pins here, because this is the cable type selector. This lets you select what type of cable you will be using for data transfer. And this is the video signal selector. Here you can choose between PAL and NTSC. Depending on the type of cable that you're using for data transfer, you have to close either these two pins or these two. For a standard RS-232 cable, you have to close these two. And for a 9 modem cable, you have to close these two. I use a standard cable, so I'll put in the jumpers here. And the other one here. And now my CB2 micro is configured to be used with a standard cable. And now for the video signal jumper. The CB2 micro normally produces a PAL TV signal. So if you live in Europe or Australia, for example, you don't need to put in any jumper here. But if you live in North America or Central America or Japan, for example, you have to put a jumper here, and then the CB2 micro will create an appropriate signal for your NTSC TV set. But it's always good to have pins here, because when you should develop games or any other time-critical software and you sync it to the TV signal, then you can easily test it on both video systems just by adding or removing this little jumper. And now let's get into business. Let's see how to use our little computer. When you power it up, you get to this sort of graphical user interface, and it's quite easy to use, but there's a few things that you should know. On the top, we have 8 slots named P1 to P8. You can move along these with the cursor keys. And here you can store up to 8 different programs. And these are stored persistently on the 80 mega, so you don't need any external storage. Below that, we have 3 predefined items. You can't change these. And below, we see some status information. For example, the video system and the keyboard type we are using. And the multicolored line at the bottom always shows us the meaning of the escape key and the function keys F1 to F4. Now, if you want to run one of these programs, you first select it with the cursor keys, then you press Enter to start it, and here we are. And now, if you want to end it again, you would first try to press escape, but the escape key is just not supported here in this game. So we press Ctrl C to end any basic program. And now the execution has stopped and the developer could now enter the debugger, but this is not what we want to do. We press escape at this point, and here we are at the startup screen again. And let's try this little game, and we press Ctrl C, then escape, and then we're back at the startup screen again. Let's now take a look at the meaning of the different colors that these icons have. You notice that many of them are white. A white icon stands for a basic program. On the top left, we have a yellow icon. This is a text file. And text files always have names with a leading underscore. And on P2 we have a green icon. This is a binary executable file. But most of the files on our CB2 micro will be basic programs having white icons. If you want to take a look at the basic code of one of these programs, you first select it, and let's take a look at the bottom line. Then red, we have the meaning of the escape key, which has no function here, and we have the four function keys F1 to F4. So that means edit in yellow stands for the F1 key and run in magenta stands for the F4 key. So we press F1 and here we are inside the basic code, and here we can move along with the page up, page down keys. And if we take a look at the bottom line again, there it says in red exit. So that means that the escape key brings us back to the startup screen again. So I think that's about all you need to know for a start. I hope you enjoyed this second video on the CB2 micro, and I will end it with a little game featuring our favorite dot eating guy. See you next time. Bye bye.